This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Behind the Headlines is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
This week, the City of Memphis and the Tennessee State Legislature square off in a battle over annexation. Plus, Governor Bill Haslam lays out his vision for Tennessee in his second State of the State address. These were the stories reported this week by our roundtable of journalists, Bill Dries of the Memphis Daily News, Les Smith, Fox 13 News, Amos Mackey of the Commercial Appeal, Jackson Baker of the Memphis Flyer, and hosted by Eric Barnes, publisher of the Memphis Daily News.
Welcome to Behind the Headlines. Thanks for joining us. We start tonight with annexation. And Bill, early in the week when this came up, seemingly out of nowhere, it seemed like we were going to be in a huge battle. The kind of fight that we've had over the last year over city-county school consolidation, the kind of historic fight that you know Memphis and big cities have seen over these issues of suburbs versus cities. Over the course of the week, maybe things have calmed down a bit, but let's talk about at the beginning of the week when this bill and what this bill or bills were that came up at the state legislature?
Basically, it was two bills. Let's start with a simpler one first. One would have set up a referendum requirement for annexation and also would have permitted citizens to petition for another kind of referendum to de-annex the areas that they live in from a particular city. But the main course in terms of this legislation that was proposed was a bill that would have basically taken the Grays Creek area out of the Memphis Annexation Reserve. It would have taken it out of play.
The reserve areas having been, the annexation areas having been set up in a court case back in the 90s, everyone, or a lot of people at least, thought that this was pretty set. I think we talked before the show, Amos, the city did not have this area on its radar screen to annex at any time, but suddenly this bill comes up to take that away. And it brings out calls from the mayor's office and the city council of bullying, racism,
classism.
You've meanwhile gotten, I'll go to a quote from a story in the Commercial Appeal, the residents of Fisherville, which are in the middle of this area. Actually, I'm going to go to the other quote, which is, that's what we were really talking about, if I can get that. Excuse me. This is a Fisherville resident talking about how, you know, their distaste for the city of Memphis. A resident, John Bogan of the Fisherville Civic Club, says, that's what we're really talking about, an organization that is totally mismanaged, crime out of the gazoo, can't educate their people, can't manage their money, so who the heck would we want to be a part of that? And so real tempers early in the week were high, very high. But over the course of the week, Les, and you were up in Nashville, I think, this week, maybe things have kind of calmed down a little bit, and there's a little more sense that this sense of annexation and changing the rules around annexation maybe is not so inevitable.
What we have here is a failure to communicate on all sides in this particular thing. Now, in terms of Curry Todd and his involvement in this Norris Todd Bill 2 is what they're labeling it, he says that he was asked by the people of Fisherville. There was a petition drive, and there were many influential people in this little community who came to him and said, we need your help. And he says, this is the only reason that he responded is because he was asked to help as part of his constituency. And so therefore you had this Norris Todd Bill too. But it's always interesting. We went up to Nashville on Tuesday to get the word from the horse's mouth, so to speak, from Curry Todd to find out what this is all about.
Rule number one with Collierville State Representative Curry Todd. Whether a colleague, foe, or media member, if you shoot it to him straight, he'll give it to you straight. So what's the real deal on his proposed bill to switch control of a large annexation reserve from Memphis to Shelby County control, effectively blocking the city's growth plans?
Don't even know if we're going to move it. We don't know if it's going to be constitutional. That's what we got to figure out.
As promised, Todd delivered a straight answer. Yet it's his history to shoot it to you straight, which has perplexed, irritated, and alienated him as a member of the current Shelby County delegation in the Tennessee General Assembly, and prompted damning cries of racist and bully from Memphis City officials, including Mayor A.C. Wharton. In a lengthy interview on Tuesday in Nashville, Todd defended his actions and patiently responded to every question we asked, and there were plenty. For instance, while he confirms he still considers himself a member of the county delegation, he has had growing concerns with their agenda over the years.
We get put into a situation that everything's either going to be race-based or it's going to be Democrat, Republican. I'm tired of that. I'm tired of it. I want to be a part of the overall community and overall goal to make things happen down there. And but if we keep going on this track, we're never going to get anything done.
However, Todd's dander did perceptibly rise when asked his reaction to accusations of racism being leveled at his latest legislation, which is co-sponsored in the Senate by Collierville's Mark Norris.
That's way over the top. It's way over the board. Anybody that knows me knows that I'm not that type of person or individual. I don't do things based on race, you know, based on classism or bullying, you know, is what I would have been described as. And I think that's a slap in Senator Norris in my face. I think they're jumping to conclusions. It's like the circus, you know, it's like the lions jumping through the hoops.
But yet, how hard would it have been for Curry Todd to get on the phone to Mayor A.C. Wharton or any Memphis City officials and say, hey, look, I'm doing this just to serve our constituents?
Right. I mean, even in the interview, you can see there's so much distrust. And you were up, I think, in Nashville also this week, Jackson, talking to Senator Norris, among others. He is the other sponsor who is saying, we have a quote from him in a minute, but tell us what you heard from Senator Norris.
Well, he is at this point eager to distance himself from this whole fracas, making the point that he too thinks that these bills are unconstitutional because they're functioning as private acts under conditions where you can't have private acts. But he put his name on them, and the reason why the city reacted with such vigor to this is there's a history here. Yep. Back in 19, the reason there's a 1998 accord that's been breached by these two bills is that there was a stealth bill passed through the legislature in 1997 affecting the annexation of Hickory Width by Oakland. That's in Fayette County. That was John Wilder put that through kind of on the sly. Apparently that's all he had in mind, but other people exploited that bill, and soon you had about 25 municipalities brewing in Shelby County, which would absolutely shut Memphis's annexation down. So the city, the mayor, and most members of the council smelled a fish in this fishable thing and saw it really as kind of a military probe and responded to it that way. Norris was saying, look, it was not that kind of thing, but Mark Norris is a majority leader. He's a constitutional lawyer. Why would he put his name on something like this? This is a question people in the city are still asking.
Right, and let's hear from Mark Norris and his comments on this.
I have told just about everyone I can find that I think there are constitutional impediments to the legislation, the way it's drafted as an accommodation to them. I filed it. And, you know, I regret that it's as disruptive as it is, but there have probably been, you know, there's several thousand bills that get filed and get resolved in other ways, and this will probably be one of them.
This very accommodating tone didn't mean to ruffle anybody's feathers, but it was pretty ruffled early in the week. Last comment from you, and I'll get Amos' statement.
Again, another fact that ruffled feathers was that last year at this very time, Mark Norris with Curry Todd and with Ron Lawler, the other person involved, is an unacknowledged co-author of the Norris Todd bill. Those are the three people who are responsible for that. Here they are again. It looked funny.
Well, and from the, you know, you say Norris Todd, and from the point of view of a lot of folks in the suburbs particularly, that they are saviors. They're heroes. They are defending the school district. To a lot of folks in the city, Amos, they are not so heroic. And so I think that's an interesting thing we talked about before the show is that failure to communicate, what Les mentioned. The city felt like they were caught off guard. If these bills were really put out there but were unlikely to pass, why wasn't there more communication?
That's correct, because you saw the immediate reaction from the city, and it's really reflective of this gulf of trust. I mean, there is a huge disconnect between suburban legislators in Nashville and City of Memphis officials. So the first reaction, Jackson's right, there is a lot of history here. It goes with the school consolidation, with everything else. I think Memphis officials in some ways feel that they're under siege. And this was just another volley in this war against Memphis. So the reaction was swift, severe. They scheduled annexation ordinance quickly. They put a timetable to finalize that ordinance if this legislation goes through. now everybody has kind of taken a step back from the ledge. They'll say, well, let's see what the AG says. Everyone expects it to be declared unconstitutional. So we're in a bit of a holding pattern
now. And let's hear from, this was later in the week, we'll hear from A.C. Wharton and I believe Shea Flynn from the city council when tempers have maybe calmed down a little bit. Let's listen to that.
I don't want us to go into this for purely political reasons. I want us to take the time to study it, evaluate it on the merits of the annexation, not based on the behavior of Nashville, which I do not support in the least.
We've got to be much more vigilant and read every bill with a fine-tooth comb and come back and let the citizens know if we feel it's harmful to the interest of the citizens of our city and the city of Memphis.
Again, that sense of distrust that we talked about, that although they're at the mode of trying to say, look, things are not as bad as we thought they were, but there's still that sense of distrust. And I'm going to go to Bill here real quickly and say, some of us, as we've talked about this, think we're emphasizing failure to communicate. Bill, you had a sort of different take that, in a way, this goes back to the schools, that there is no coincidence that this annexation area that's under question is really central to the suburban school districts being able to form their own school districts in this new world.
Right. All five of the consultant reports that outline school districts for these municipalities include within their provisional territory some of the land in the annexation reserve area for the city of Memphis. Also, what this has had the effect of doing, I think, is making it that much harder for the group drafting the plan for a consolidated school district to come forward and really have a clean shot at putting this before the public.
Right. Annexation, last comment from you.
This is a replay of what we've seen for years. We saw it in Hickory Hill. We've seen it in Cordova. For the good people of Fisherville, yes, they are concerned. So you should be concerned. I mean, this is a city that's having trouble just putting out just regular services. And now they're talking about coming in and we're going to take it. Oh, we're going to give you police services. But the quality of service to the core area is still of some question. So I can understand why the people of Fisherville would be concerned.
Right. All right. And just technically, the ordinance to annex is, or the move to annex is on the agenda at the city, but there are more steps, and they aren't
first
rushing
reading.
Through that. The first reading, but okay. they aren't fast tracking that.
They will go through the second reading. Bill Marsh and the chairman told me last night. They will go that far.
Okay. We move now to the schools. Bill mentioned that how this annexation issue plays into that, and we had some more news and change of heart almost, Jackson. The transition commission that is supposed to put together the plan for consolidating these school districts. David Pickler is a key part of that from the suburbs, former head of the former Shelby County school system. And he came out saying what this week?
Well, he has been widely regarded. Amos has testified this on countless occasions over the months. He has been regarded as the father of this whole fracas when he said after the election of 2010, when he was chairman of the county school board, now's the time to have a special school district in Shelby County. And this supposedly galvanized Martavius Jones and Tamika Hart on the city board to push for the surrender of the charter and force merger and so forth. Actually, Martavius had already been thinking about this. That's a fact. But Pickler got stuck with that role. During this year when he's been on the Transition Planning Committee as well as the Uniform School Board, he has been at pains to be saying things like, we've got to make this thing work. Let's all work together. And Amos has commented on that as well. Amos, we're back to square one. Because he, in an interview he gave me this past weekend, he said, look, we're going to have to make allowance for these municipal school districts. We're going to have to make allowance for charter schools. We're going to have to make allowance for the administrative school district run out of Nashville for failing schools. We cannot have a single unitary system. Up to this point, the Transition Planning Committee has been acting really in la-la land, as if all they're doing is going to merge these two systems, even with members on that committee who were trying to get city districts established.
And I'm going to read from your article. This is a quote from David Pickler. I think what we're going to have to do with the Transition Planning Committee is understand and embrace these new realities, and I think we need to come up with at least one or more alternatives. We also heard that tone from Mark Luttrell this week, I think, coming out and saying, look, we can't ignore the fact that there's all this movement towards separate school systems, Bill. What does this mean? Does this blow up the Transition Planning Committee? Have they been operating in law la land, to quote Jackson?
I'll disagree with Jackson on that. I don't think they have. I think that they knew there was going to be a discussion on the possibility of charter schools. I think that they maybe thought that the municipal school districts then could proceed on a separate track from them. Mayor Luttrell, at their regular Thursday meeting, basically made a stand and said, I think the committee's doing good work, but we are not selling it as well as we could. I mean, they've basically been overtaken by events on the front of selling it to the public. But there was always an acknowledgement that the structure that they suggested or worked toward for the new school system could possibly consider, for instance, a chancery model where you had several sub-districts within a larger school district. That's always been a possibility that they have thought the structure could include.
Amos.
It's a reminder that they're not operating in a vacuum and that they should keep an open mind. I really think that's what this boils down to. And a reminder that there are powerful interests in the legislature, have a keen interest in this, and can shape things for us if we don't shape it the right way ourselves.
Which is what Pickler said, Senator Narcisse's bill. Actually, the chancery model was discussed along with several alternatives at yesterday's meeting of the transition committee. And Mayor Keith McDonald, a member of that committee, who is, we know is seeking an independent district for Bartlett, said, look, beyond all that, can we get these municipal school districts on the agenda too? And they kind of put that off till next week when this was a committee meeting and when the full transition commission meets. But they're going to deal with that. Can we deal with those, not chancery model, but separate school districts as part of the framework?
Well, the whole question is autonomy. Can there be some degree of autonomy that the suburban mayors and advocates of the municipal school districts can be satisfied with within a countywide school system?
And the parents can be satisfied with.
And, yeah.
Okay. All right, we move on to early in the week, State of the State, Governor Bill Haslam, his annual address, second address in his second term. Bill, what did we hear?
We heard a lot of talk about the state workforce. We also heard a lot of talk about, even though projections for state revenue are seen to be near the pre-recession levels, that Haslam is not taking his foot off the gas when it comes to basically reshaping state government to something that he thinks it needs to evolve to. Early on, he kind of set the general tone for this by quoting Mark Twain.
It's here that it's best for all of us to remember what Mark Twain said about the taxpayer's dollar. It's tainted. It taint yours and it taint mine.
He also talked about the state workforce in particular. He is going to launch some major reforms in terms of how state employees can move around as he downsizes the number of jobs in state.
Yeah, we learned a lot. If anyone watched our live coverage, we learned a lot about bumping.
Jackson. Yeah.
The concept of bumping and putting an end to bumping at state government.
Bumping is how you say it if you're looking at it from one vantage point. Seniority is the issue from the other vantage point.
Yeah, and that is basically the system, the example he used, in which a state employee who has 10 years experience, and you know, if they are getting pushed out of a job, they can pick any other job, I guess, throughout the state government, even if somebody has 9.5 years of experience. And he says that's an inefficient way and a silly way to do business. And I think we heard less throughout the talk, and we talked about it at the time, this is a business person. This is a CEO.
Yes.
He's the CEO governor. He talked about customer service. He talked about, you know, return measurable results. He talked the language of business in terms of presenting his plan for government.
I thought it was interesting considering the presidential backdrop, and you have Mitt Romney, who is out there saying that a businessman can run this country. Well, we have a businessman who's trying to run state government, and from what we've seen in his first year, it's pretty efficient. I mean, on his part,
right.
He stays above the fray. He gets everything he needs passed, and he stays out of it.
And he stays out of a lot of the ideology. I mean, you get the extreme, I shouldn't use the word extreme, but from a lot of people point of view, extreme views of, say, Stacey Campfield, a state senator out of Knoxville, talking about a lot of social issues. You get extreme, issues on the other end. He stays out of that fray and tries to manage the state budget and manage the employees, the workers of the state. We also heard, in specific to Memphis, Amos, some good news, I guess, in terms of funding of capital investment in local education institutions and just the general, you know, support of economic development initiatives statewide, including Memphis. Tell us a little bit about what Memphis got out of this presentation.
University of Memphis, Southwest Tennessee, University of Tennessee Health Sciences Center will all get significant investments from the governor, who does, you know, have close ties to Memphis. It was interesting. I think what you see is a governor who's really comfortable with himself. He's not trying to be something he's not. Like you mentioned, he's not on far on the right side. He's not on the far left side. He knows who he is. He knows what he's there to do. He knows what he campaigned on, and that's where his focus is. And as a regular citizen, that is somewhat refreshing. I thought it was interesting his take on, these state hiring and moving around, that's what maddens a lot of regular citizens. You know, where maybe you have an employee who is not very good, who simply gets to keep their job or get a better job just because they've been there longer. I mean, that is stuff that the average person gets, and I think the governor gets that, and that's why you see him taking that step.
All right, we'll go now, speaking of economics and CEOs, Bill, a whole lot of economic news of Memphis and Memphis-related companies this week. I mean, I'll set the backdrop is that there is this, you know, technically we've come out of the recession as a country. A lot of people, of course, don't feel that. That tends to lag. But even this Friday, the U.S. unemployment rate fell again. The economy added 243,000 jobs. And against that backdrop of lots of signs of improvement, we've got probably more signs of good news business-wise in Memphis, but also some signs of bad news. Let's walk through it.
Yeah. We had Thomas & Betts, of course, is being acquired by ABB, which is a global company, as Thomas & Betts is. And once again, we've seen this phenomenon of a Memphis-based company like Morgan Keegan being bought by an out-of-town company, but saying Memphis is going to remain a center for the consolidated business and will be a center of an
right.
important part of their business here.
Let's go to the quote box, actually, that talks a little bit about the details on the acquisition. Both companies' board of directors have agreed to a deal in which ABB, a Swiss company, will buy Thomas & Betts for $72 a share, or about $3.9 billion total. And they were talking the things, I guess, from a Memphis point of view you want to hear, that they love what Thomas & Betts does in terms of logistics, and mm-hmm. they don't have a big presence in North America, so there's less of a sense that, hey, they're going to up and move this company somewhere else and a lot of jobs with it.
Right, right.
And we move on to, let's go on to International Paper, reported a great, I guess it's best year in nearly 20 years, net earnings of $1.3 billion compared to $644 million last year. Talk about it, International Paper.
This is a company which also had a pretty significant event of its own during the past year, and that is its acquisition of one of its competitors, one of its main competitors, Temple Inland, a paper company that's based in Austin, Texas. That will continue to unfold. Great American Steamboat Company, a much smaller company in its scope, nevertheless has plans to hire several hundred people here
right.
for their riverboat cruises that begin on the American Queen starting in April. They're going to have a job fair next month for those several hundred jobs.
This was one, Amos, one of those big stories from last year. The city got behind this, really was part of making it happen in terms of funding the ability of the riverboat to return to Memphis.
We'll start seeing more and more of this. These projects that the chamber and Mayor Wharton and Mayor Luttrell worked on right when they got into office. Now we'll start to see the fruit of those labors.
Mitsubishi,
Electrolux, American Steamboat Company,
right.
City Brewing.
Okay.
That's there's good news to come.
Okay. We move there to the sidebar, last segment today, and we'll just go around the table with some of the bigger stories, quick hits. I'm going to start with you, Jackson. Quick hit from this last week.
Well, we've talked about how the presidential candidates will fare in Tennessee. Newt Gingrich is newly appointed co-chairs in Tennessee, or two legislators, Stacey Campbell and Tony Shipley, maybe the two most insignificant members of the Republican Party in Tennessee. And that's his boys.
Okay. We have some news from Midtown around Overton Square, Bill.
Yeah, the French Quarter Inn has some new owners with plans to renovate the hotel, possibly as a comfort inn. They took that plan to the folks in Midtown earlier this week to talk about it. Their plan is basically a hotel. They're not going to try to compete for the entertainment district business with their friends across the street. So we'll see how this works out.
Okay, I'll do a quick sidebar hit. We meant to touch on in the economic roundup, which is Smith & Nephew, which has a big presence here, did a big bunch of layoffs towards the end of last year. They announced further reductions globally, 7% of their workforce. They employ about 2,000 people here. That's not good news. I always like to do good news in the sidebar, but that's just not one I could get to. Amos, you, sidebar.
South Haven Mayor Greg Davis under investigation for misuse of public funds. Basically gives the middle finger to auditors and aldermen. He says he's not going to step down, and that aldermen twisted his words about deceiving them about his sex life into deceiving them about his okay. mixing business and government.
All right. And Les, you get the fun one.
I get the fun one. 6,000 commercials. 6,000 people come out, and Doritos is saying, okay, we want applications for a spot that's going to run in the Super Bowl. Well, locally, a guy named Jimmy Duke, who is from here, he's now reached the finalist stage with his commercial produced here in Memphis. And here's a plug, a part of it that's going to be on Super Bowl Sunday. Let's look at this.
What's up with Gary? Every time he craves Doritos, he turns into a bird of prey.
Really? A bird?
Watch this.
Everybody loves sophomoric humor, don't we? There's a guy just ramming his head, and that's what we get a lot of that on Super Bowl Sunday.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. That's good.
That's good.
And our last moment, the big news of the week is the birthday of one Amos Mackey. I believe that is today, 22, I believe.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, happy birthday. We leave it there. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next week.